Hebrews chapter number 10. Want to look at our foundational text, Hebrews chapter number 10, and verse 35 and verse 6. It is our custom to stand for the reading of the word. I will wait. When you advance, I have his word. Hebrews chapter number 10, beginning at verse number 35. It says, cast not away therefore your confidence, which has great recompense of reward. For ye have need of patience, that after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise. Look at the person by you and tell them, say, neighbor, it's going to be important that you maintain your confidence in God. Let's pray. Father of heaven, thank you again for this time of sharing your word with these your sheep. Father, I pray first that you would clear my mind. Let me hear, Father, from you. Speak to me, God. Think through my mind. Speak to these lips of clay, that I might only articulate, Father, those things that you have done to my spirit. And then I pray, God, that you will open up the ears of the hearer, that we might hear you, Father, behind the voice. I thank you now, and I give you in glory and honor. In Jesus' name I do pray. Somebody say amen. Amen. You may have your seat in the presence of the Lord. We are in another part of our lesson entitled, how to maintain confidence in God. Yes. How many of you all know that it's vitally important that you and I maintain our confidence in God? Yes. As a matter of fact, once the person by you for the first time and tell them, say, you've got to maintain confidence in God. Yes. I'm not sure how many of you all even listen to Christian or watch Christian television or listen to Christian radio, but for quite a while, I've been hearing this thought process of having confidence in God. I've heard it over and over again for weeks now. And I believe that God, you all, is trying to cause his people to get on program with him. Wow. Understand, the Bible says that one of the signs that we are living in the last days is that there will be a great falling away. And I'm not sure about you, but I have noticed, you all, that as time is passing, that there are many of God's children who are falling by the wayside. There are some of God's children that maybe they're not falling by the wayside, but they have lost their confidence in God. And for whatever the issue may be, there are many of God's children who have chosen to give up on God, because God maybe has not done for them or brought into manifestation those things which they have been praying for and believing for. Let me ask you this. How many of you all, you've been praying and believing for something a long time? The person who held up, trust the person by and tell them, say, whatever you do, don't give up on how you believe. And I believe with all of my heart, that has been one of the downfalls, you all, in Christianity. Because understand, when it comes to having faith in God, watch this now, look at me. Having faith in God simply says, I believe what God has said, and I receive it as so right now, even if I don't see it in my hand. You see, what we do is we believe that having faith in God is that we learn to praise God after we have already receive or see in our hand that we have it. But that's not what the word of God says. Jesus says, blessed is he that believe and have not seen. And what we want to do is make God, put God in our circle and make God adjust to our belief system. But understand, real Bible faith, you all, is having the capacity to believe that it is already done, even if you don't see it yet. Somebody say, I believe it's already done. Now understand, family, as you and I begin to believe, or we sit from the position of knowing that it's already done, what we now do is take the power out of the hand of the enemy. How many of you all want to take the power out of the hand of the enemy? See, some of us give the devil way too much power in our lives. And he has convinced us that this thing called Christianity does not work. Pastor, how do you know he's convinced us that it don't work? Well, I can tell, number one, by your response to him. Let me see if I can say it like this. You know when somebody does not love you based on their response to you. Okay, let me see if I can help our sisters out just a little bit. See, you can tell, baby, when he stopped loving you and he's loving somebody else, because the things he used to do, he don't do no more. Or even when he does it reluctantly and does it grudgingly, because he feels as though now you are making him do, watch this now, what's not really in him. And how many of you know that it's hard to love somebody the way they deserve to be loved when loving them really is not in you? Oh, I can't get a talk back church this morning. Okay, let me see if I can help the brothers. Since the sisters couldn't say amen, I'm going to help a few brothers out. Brothers, you know when she has stopped loving you. After, how do you know? Let me tell you. First of all, she quit cleaning up behind you. Number two, listen, the food that used to be on the table at 5 o'clock now has been pushed to 8 o'clock, and you've been home for 3 hours and you haven't eaten yet. Okay, let me see if I can come down your road. When you tap her on the shoulder before, she turned over and said, baby, come on, whatever you want to do, come on, do it. But now when you tap on the same shoulder, she said, can't you see I'm asleep? You can tell when the thrill is gone. Come here, baby king. He said that the thrill is gone away from me.
Look out now.
And see, there are many of God's children who are still going through the ritual of Christianity. They come through the ritual of coming to God's house. But watch this, the love of God is not in them based on things they have gone through. Right. And how many of you know that when you are going through tests and trials over the course of your life, sometimes it is easy for your confidence to dwindle. But understand, what causes our confidence then to dwindle is, watch this now, is that we have taken the source of our supply and put it on someone else. Come on, class, say, God must be the only source of my life. You see, too many of God's children, you all, they have made other things and other people their source. Listen, they have made people, they made their boo their source, they made the government their source, they made their job their source. How many of you know that? Listen, your job can shut down anytime it wants to. Come on. As a matter of fact, I don't think, not many of us in here, you are the entrepreneur of your own business right now. And so you are hoping and praying every Friday that when you get your check, you are praying, God, please let this thing go through. But understand, at any given moment, the government has given them a carte blanche to shut down their business and leave you hanging, and you still can't pay the bills on time, no way. And what makes many of us freak out is because we have made the job our supply. But come on, say, the job is not my source. Come on, say, my job is not my source. Listen, your SSI is not your source. Whatever your main income is, that is not your source. It is important then that you and I understand that until God becomes our only supply and God becomes our only source, we'll keep looking for everyone else to bail us out. And God, the Bible says, looking unto Jesus, who is the author, come on, and the finisher of my faith. And so what many Christians you all have done is that we have, watch this now, many of the Christians have made God, watch this now, look at me, we've made God optional. All right. I'll say it again. We've made God optional rather than the source. Pastor, what do you mean? See, watch this. When something is an option, it opens up the way for your opinion to be leveled above have, I'm not sure, but if I was God, some things, I wouldn't give us y'all all these options.
Okay.
Because when you give options, your options say that either I can do this or that. But how many of y'all understand that in the system of God, it is never either or. It is what God says must be done. As a matter of fact, just the person by time say, in God's system, it is not either or. See, the Bible says there is a way, watch this now, that seems right to a man. God says that way you are trying to embrace may seem right, but God says if that way you are trying to embrace it does not line up with my way of doing things, then God said that your way will lead you to certain destruction. How many of y'all, you are tired of going through the same old thing over and over again in your life? Now listen, I challenge you then that as a child of God, what all of us must do then is ask the question, God, what's going on in my life? Could it be me? Come on, class, say, could it be me? Put your hand on yourself and say, could it be me? I see, one of the things we don't want to do is many times, none of us ever want to realize that we are the real problem in our lives. Because, Brother Rice, it is easy for me to blame you for what's going on in my life. But Michael Jackson had a song that said, sometimes you must look at the man in the mirror. Because I have learned, child of God, that when you and I come face to face with our own reality and ask the real question, who is the one responsible for the hell I'm going through? Who is the one responsible for the trouble I'm experiencing in my life? Could it be that I refuse to do things the way God has told me to do? Come on, class, say, I must live my life according to the plans of God. Come on, class, say, I must live my life according to the plans of God. I know we're today, listen, today I won't hit every row in the house today, because what the devil has made us believe that we can live our life based on whatever option we choose. I figured I wouldn't give any amen right there. I got one okay and an over here.
All right.
I didn't even get an all right now.
All right.
But here, children of God, in the system of God, we don't get the option of living life any kind of way.
Amen.
And when you and I decide that we're going to do things our own way, what we have done then is we have left God out of the equation.
Amen.
And understand, anytime you and I leave God then out the equation, God is no longer obligated to do for you what he said he would do for you. Now, I know what some of you want God to do is to overlook what you've done, overlook what you said, overlook how you feel, and overlook how you think, and say, God, come on, get on my buddy plan. But how many folk know that God is never going to jump on your plan? You see, it's almost like having folks, see, some of y'all got too many folks on your cell phone plan. Don't raise your hand, but you know, you have more than 2-3 folks on your cell phone plan. See, you run out of data.
All right.
You run out of data. Because sometimes they go on their phone and they're on the web all day long.
That's it.
Just searching the web.
Talk about it.
They on Facebook. They on your book. They on my book. They watch 3-hour movies. And who knows what else they're watching. And then you look at it, all the data is gone. And now here you are, if you're the one paying the bill, and you don't want to go for your phone and look for your own. You want to find one Bible verse, but you can't because there is no data. And if you decide that I'm going to go online anyway, when the bill comes at the end of the month, you look up, and now you've been incurred more charges because you used something, watch this, you used something where there was no payment already made. And one of the reasons God's children, you all, they are giving up on God, is watch this now, is because they're trying to pay their own way. Is there any somebody shout, it's gonna work out in my favor. Now watch this, watch this, watch this, watch this. When you talk about opinion, your opinion opens up a way for you to exercise an option to be leveled above God's thinking. But when God, you all, what's now, when God is the source, you understand this one thing, that there is no source or no other place where which I can draw my supply. Come on, Pastor, there is no other place I can draw my supply. Can anybody in the house today testify that when you were in trouble, it was nobody but God that brought you out? Come on, when you were sick, only God got the credit for healing your body. Come on, beside me, anybody ever gone through anything in your life and you were glad that God brought you out of the thing that you were in? Come on, maybe on your job they were going to lay you off or close the whole company down, but some kind of way God gave you favor and they fired folks who were more qualified, who had more time, who had more experience, but God gave you favor. Somebody shout favor, favor, favor. There have been times in my life where I was down and couldn't find a friend, but I'm glad that I serve a God that knows how to pull me up by my bootstraps. And every time I want to spend my days crying and spend my nights feeling sorry for myself, that God got a way of picking me up and helping me and give me a brand new start. Somebody said, he'll pick you up, pick you up, pick you up. Now watch this. When we begin our journey, you all, in this lesson, yes, yes. I gave you all 5 points that you needed to write down and to understand. And in those 5 points, I told you, please, whatever you do, as long as you live, don't ever forget these 5 points. Mm-hmm. I'm going to run through them real fast, and I'm going to get into today's lesson. I said, number one, that God means what he says, and what he says is so. I said, number two, that God has the ability to back up whatever he says. Number three, I said that God is not rushed by the passing of time. Number four, I said God's plan does not change because we face moments of inconvenience. And I said, number five, when God expects you and I to trust him through the process. Come on, class, say, God expects you and I to trust him in the process. Now, I left off you all on last week giving you these 3 points. I said, number one was endurance, stamina, and persistence. Come on, class, say, endurance, stamina, persistence. Now, endurance, you all, suggests that whatever the journey takes me, I will preserve to get the promise. Stamina suggests that there is a resilience to keep moving forward. And persistence will suggest that someone who is determined to get all God has for you. Is there anybody in the house who's determined to get all God has for you? And encourage the person behind him and say, neighbor, you better be determined to get all God has for you. Now this morning, you all, I want to tap right here into this lesson here, because I believe that this ties into everything right here, that God's plan does not change because we face moments of inconvenience. Let me ask you all, how many times have you all heard God tell you a thing, but that thing looked to be inconvenient to your life? Okay, then, let me see, I'm going to come down the road right away. See, the word commands us to tithe. Yes, sir. But for some of God's folk, tithing is an inconvenience. All right. The word commands us to pray. Yeah. But for some of God's folks, the praying for them is an inconvenience. The word calls for us to love our neighbor and ourselves. But for some of us, loving somebody is an inconvenience. Yeah. How many folk, at any time, God gives you a command that God really isn't concerned about your inconvenience? Now, I know you would love that God would be considerate about your being inconvenienced. But listen, child of God, when God gives you a command, watch this, he really does not care about your inconvenience. Let me see if I can give you some Bible. Pastor, come on now. Give me some word. Watch this. When God told Naaman, God said, or Elijah, tell Naaman to dip 7 times in the pool of the Jordan. Now understand, Naaman was a captain of the host. Naaman was a man of prestige. You would have thought that Elijah would have come to him, laid hands on him, and did everything in secret. But watch this. Many times when God wants to get something out of you, he will give you an instruction. Watch this. This is see if you are so full of pride that you won't obey his instruction. Now understand, Jordan, you all, was a dirty, low-lying level pool of water. And everything flowed into the Jordan. And so God, the word from the prophet said, Naaman, if you want to be healed, go dip 7 times. Now watch this. Like many of us, Naaman got an attitude. Anybody in the house know folk who get attitudes with God? I know you can't say amen, but listen, because it could be you. Because sometimes folk get angry with God because when we read what God says, and now the word of God holds us accountable, and we really don't want to do what the word of God is telling us to do. And so the word came from the prophet says, Naaman, go dip 7 times. And Naaman had a bad attitude. What you mean, man of God, go dip over there in the dirty pool 7 times? Watch this. Don't you know who I am? I wonder how many times we told God, God, don't you know who I am? God, don't you know I got more degrees than in the mountain? Don't you know who I am? What you mean, God, lift my hand and pray to God? God, don't you know who I am? God, don't you know I work all week? I don't want to raise my hand. I don't want to get you pray. God, don't you know? Don't worry, I'm coming for you today. Don't you know, God, who I am? And watch this. We don't tell God with our mouths, but we tell God, God, what you're telling me to do is inconveniencing me. But watch this. Anytime God gives you an instruction, child of God, don't miss this. Your deliverance is in the instruction. Ooh, y'all ain't giving me yet. Come on, say, my deliverance is in the instruction. You see, when God gives us an instruction, God never gives us a command just to make us angry. When God says, thou shalt not, the only reason God says, thou shalt not, watch this, is to not to keep you from having fun, but to protect you from you. Oh, I can't get an amen, man. But how many folks, now watch this, if you look at your own life, how many folks can testify that some of the stuff that's in my life right now, I jack my own self up? Okay, maybe it's just your pastor. I've been some places and I jack my own self up. I said some stuff and I jack my own self up. Come on, I've done some things and I messed, maybe it's just me. I messed my own self up. But when God gives us an instruction, it is to protect you. God wants to make sure that our lives, watch this now, lead to the place, to the assignment he asked for us. Maybe I'm in the wrong church. How many of you all want God to lead your life, or would you rather lead your own life? Come on, how many folks say, Lord, please lead my life? How many say, Lord, don't worry, I got this thing by myself. Come on, because I got a whole bottle of oil right here, I'm going to drown you today. Now watch this now. We show God by our actions that God, really, I don't need your assistance. Watch this. What made Naaman do what the prophet told him to do was that God had a little slave girl to go and tell Naaman, Naaman, had the prophet gave you some hard thing, you would have to do it. He gave you something simple, and the only thing you had to do was do the instruction.
All right.
Isn't it amazing how even God's folk don't like instructions? Let me see if I can say it then like this. See, when everybody in here, when you are a baby, I don't care if mama said, don't touch that stove. Something on the inside of you. I just got to see if it's hot. Because you didn't really know what hot was. Brother Rice, like mine, don't go over there. And the kid walk away and look back. As soon as you leave, I'm going to do the very thing you told me to do. Oh, come on, you know, well, it's almost in like Adam. God said, Adam, of a tree in the middle of the garden, that's the one you don't eat from. And as soon as God turned his head, here comes a serpent. Came to Eve. Eve, come on. You mean that God said don't eat or touch it? Well, you know, God did say that. And she ate it and brought mankind down because they wouldn't follow an instruction. I just wonder on this morning how many of God's folks have messed their own life up because they refuse to follow an instruction. Come on, can I say, I must follow the instructions. Watch this. Watch this. Watch this. I'm going to give you an illustration. Watch this. What is this? Watch this. The flashlight today represents your body. What is this?
Your body.
Your body. I can say that. But watch this. This flashlight got a big head. I ain't gonna say that either.
All right, Pastor.
Now watch this. The flashlight represents your body. What's in the flashlight represents the Holy Spirit.
All right.
It's called batteries. The flashlight is only good in the dark. Yes. How many folks are supposed to go around all day long with a flashlight just flashing? Come on, I can't see you. All this light in here, I can't see. But now watch this. You have a flashlight, which is your body. You have in the flashlight Holy Spirit, which you cannot see.
Mm-hmm. All right.
This little button right here, watch this. This button right here is what you turn on to make manifest what's on the inside. It's supposed to come outside. Now watch this. The Bible said over Colossians, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Holy Spirit is on the inside of you. What you are praying for is on the inside of you. But you cannot get a manifestation of light if you won't obey the instruction to cut the switch on. See, some of y'all, the reason God can't cut the switch on in your life is because the Holy Spirit is giving you an instruction. You tell him, you know what, I don't need your instruction.
All right.
I wonder if I get a little Levi over here and say, Levi, cut this flashlight on. He going to watch this. He going to look at it. He going to turn it upside down. And watch this. His mind says, I'm going to eat it. Because it's probably something I can put in my mouth. Now, what is obvious is it's metal, it's hard. Watch this, and it'll kill him if you put it down far enough. But his mind convinces him that I can eat this thing, and so what he does is put it in his mouth. The Bible says, as long as you remain a child, you differ nothing from a servant. God says, until you grow up and learn how to follow my instructions, you will never get what I said. It's already yours. Would you push the person right and say, neighbor, you will never get what God said is yours if you can't follow simple instructions. Write this down. You determine what stops the flow or release the flow, not God. I'll say it again. You determine what stops the flow or releases the flow, not God. I know you think that God, that everything God said or planned will happen automatic. Okay, let's just use a little common sense. If God has not given you what he promised yet, automatically, then the problem could be you. Pastor, what are you saying? Over in the book of Ephesians, chapter number 1, verse number 2, it says, God has already given us all spiritual blessings in heavenly places by Christ Jesus.
All
right. Which then suggests that everything God is going to do for us, what is wrong, is already done. See, right. Oh, thank you, Holy Spirit. Right. Watch this. The enemy, y'all, has made us look at God like Santa Claus. I'm going to go there. I'm going to say it again. The enemy has convinced us that God is like Santa Claus. Pastor, what you saying? When you were small, you were convinced that in November, right after Thanksgiving, that Santa Claus and his elves and his wife went to the North Pole.
All right.
And they started trying to put together your toys in November.
Right.
And he was through by Christmas Eve. And then he got his big old self up on a sleigh. With a few reindeers in the middle of a snowstorm. And he's riding his big old humongous self in the middle of the air with no jet. And he went to your house, to my house. Now come on, you know if Santa Claus would land on your ceiling and you saw him, and what the devil has made us believe that God is somewhere in a factory, in a workshop, trying to make our blessing.
All
right. Hear me, child, God is not somewhere trying to make your healing, trying to make your money, trying to make you a house, trying to make you a car. Everything God is going to do is already done. Something is already done. And so watch this thing. The question is, who's stopping the flow? Because if you're the one who cuts the faucet off, don't blame God because you won't follow the instructions. Okay, y'all missed that. Let me say it then. If I can say it then like this. How many of y'all, don't raise your hand, but how many of y'all at least consider in the morning taking a shower? A bath, a wash up, a wash down, have you do it? A sprinkle of the day. Now watch this. How many of you all got, you stood up in the shower and you said, all right, God, I'm ready. And God cut the water on the right temperature to fit your body. If he did, how many of you all, God took your rag, took your soap, lathered up your rag, and he said, come on, God. Come on, and God lathered you up. If he did, how many of y'all did God take you, put you back under the water, and then rinse you off, and then take you out the shower and dried you off? If you say God did that for you, something is seriously wrong with you. Now watch this. If God didn't do that, now watch that. Don't miss the point. I don't care how dirty you get. As long as water is being ran to your house, the shower is available, but if you don't cut the water on, the water won't flow. Don't hear me yet. If you don't take your hand and cut the nozzle on, I don't care how much water pressure is in the pipe, you cannot get wet until you cut the water on. Some of God's folks are angry at God because, well, I guess God not going to do what he said. Tell God it could be that you're the one who won't cut the water on. Come on, say, Lord, give me the strength to cut the water on. See, watch this. Isaiah 119 says this. Watch this now. Isaiah 119. He says, if you be willing and obedient. Somebody said, that means me. God said, if you are willing and obedient, he says, you now get to eat the good of the land.
All right.
Let me ask you, class, how many of y'all want to eat the good of the land?
Oh,
yes. How many of y'all don't care if you starve all year? Now watch this. If the responsibility then is on me, and it is based on the word of God, then what then my job then is to make sure I keep doing what the word of God says to do, even if it inconveniences me.
All right.
Okay, okay? You ain't got it yet. Watch this, watch this. The devil tells you, well, God's commandments are too hard. Now, God know I can't do all that. God see my bills. God see I'm struggling. God see I'm going through a hard place. Child of God, if you are going through a struggle in your life, that's the right time to find out what God is saying about prosperity. See, what this in the baby, Barbara, the devil always calls folk to shut their minds down anytime the word of faith is preached on prosperity. But the bad part is, everybody in here could use a little more change. All the whole church back there woke up. Because everybody in here could use a little something, something in their pocket. But why then do we allow the devil to convince us that I can't do what God says to get money in my pocket? Watch this. Can't nobody in this room go in your backyard and pray for collard greens? Watch this. I don't care, Brother Philip, I don't care how hungry you get. You can be hungry and weighing 3 pounds and say, ground, I command you to bring forth collard greens. It ain't gonna happen. But I guarantee you, get the same backyard, the same dirt, or put a seed in the same ground, and a few weeks, that same ground where there was no collard greens will bring forth the collard greens because you put a seed in the ground. Can somebody please tell me how come God's children, they want to harvest but don't want to plant a seed? You don't ever have to pray, God bless me. If you are praying, God bless me, you are praying the wrong prayer. Because where there is no seed sown, there is no place to look for a harvest. I heard one guy say, well, Pastor, you understand, well, Pastor, I do tithe. I don't ask you if you tithe. Your tithe is what you owe God. I ask you, did you put a seed in the ground? Because if you put a seed in the ground, I came to tell somebody that once you plant a baby, it's coming up again. Is there anybody here who can say it's coming up again? Yes. Now watch this. Over in 1 John chapter 5. 1 John 5 verse 3. Watch this now. John says, for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, watch this now, and his commandments, y'all, watch this, are not grievous. That word grievous in the Hebrew means it's not hard.
Right.
Somebody say it's not hard.
It's not hard.
Now come on, look at me, look at me, come on. I know you don't want to raise your hand because a person might think you're real spiritual. But how many folks on you sometimes, come on, give me some of these, that sometimes God's plan can look a little uncomfortable. Come on, give me some of these. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Every now and then, you're like, come on, God, for real? Come on. Maybe when God says do X, Y, Z, you'd be like, God, come on, stop playing with me. Come on. But watch this. You recall in Mark, Mark chapter number 2, when the folks needed some wine for a party. And Mary said, Lord, we out of wine. Now watch this. Jesus waited for a minute. He said, I tell you what you're going to do. He said, go get some water pots. Mm-hmm. And then put some water in the pot. Now how many folks that know that really don't make sense?
All right.
See, if Brother Rice, if I said, Brother Rice, go get me some wine. You're going to, first of all, probably look at me strange. Or you should. But I don't think you would go to a liquor store and say, give me a six-pack of Aquafina. Y'all missed that. That's water. You all got a 16-ounce of Aquafina. Because my request was what? Wine. Jesus says, go get some water pots. And then watch this. Put in those water pots. Watch this now. Some water.
All right.
The governor said, we need wine. Mary came to his mama. See, if mama says she wants some wine, you don't go get mama something that she don't want.
All right.
Mama said, the wine is gone, Jesus. He said, okay, give me some water. No, Lord, we need wine. Okay, give me some water. No, Lord, they want to get drunk. Give me some water. Watch this. Whenever God gives you natural reasoning. I'm going to say it again. Whenever God gives you an instruction, it will always go against your natural reasoning. And it's amazing to me how the enemy either talks to you or talks through someone else against the plan of God for your life. Okay, let me ask you this. How many of y'all have God given you a dream? Come on. Y'all want a dream? God give you a promise? Isn't it amazing how somebody will always come and tell you how it's impossible to do what God is telling you to do?
All right.
And watch this. The bad part is, Charlotte, what they say makes sense.
All right.
Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
They say, no, you can't do this because, watch this. How are you going to do it? How can this get us this when I know this is what you're looking for? But when God gives you an instruction, watch this, y'all. When God gives an instruction, it becomes God's responsibility to bring you past the very thing God told you to do. See, watch this. You recall when Jesus fed the 5,000?
Yes.
Now watch this. They were hungry. Jesus says, watch this. What do you have? And Philip gave useless information. All we have is a little boy's two-piece fish wish. Got two fish, two sardines, and five crackers. That's all we got. How in the world can we feed all these folks with two sardines? Watch this. That is not what Jesus asked him. He said, what do we have? Because the Bible said, Jesus, I'm going to shout now. He said he already knew what he was going to do. Is there anybody in the house know that Jesus already knows what he's going to do? Would you put the person behind them and say, neighbor, he already knows what he's going to do. Watch this. Break it down. When you need a miracle. Woo! Good God Almighty. Watch this. When you need a miracle, you got to look for a different manual. Y'all missed it. Pastor Mark, when you need a miracle, you have to look at a different manual. Pastor, what are you saying? You can't read the same manual and get a different result. When you need a miracle in your life, you got to look to God and say, God, I need an instruction that don't make sense. Oh, is there anybody in the house who want an uncommon blessing from the Lord? Would you shake your hand and just say, neighbor, what I need from God is an uncommon blessing, and that uncommon blessing, I need an uncommon instruction to change my life. See, what's this? You can't use the old method or an old blueprint to build a new building.
All right.
Y'all missed it. I'm going to say it again. You can't use an old blueprint to build a new structure. One of the reasons the body of Christ cannot advance because folk want to do things the way they did it back in 2010.
All right.
Come on. If things are going to progress, you must use a different manual.
Yes.
All right. Watch this. Go to Luke chapter 5. I'm almost done. Watch this. In Luke chapter number 5. Here it is, y'all. Jesus had just finished preaching the gospel of the kingdom.
All right.
And the Bible said that those who heard the word, watch this now, look at me. Those who heard the word came in and they pressed upon him. Elder Green, that part kind of made me stop reading for a second because the folks heard the word of the kingdom, and the Bible said, they want to go home. Y'all missed that. They heard the word and didn't want to go home. I'm going to say it again. They heard the word and didn't want to go home. Some church folk can't wait to get out of church. I mean, before I can say amen, they already out the door. The Bible said, watch this now, they heard the word and didn't want to leave.
Right.
Now, Now watch this. Jesus then went to Simon and said, Simon, I'm going to borrow your boat. Well, I'm sorry. He didn't even ask. He just jumped on in the boat. And the Bible said he told Simon to launch out into the deep. Now, watch this. Him using Simon's boat, you all, was not just by happenstance. Somebody say, it wasn't by happenstance. You're going to shout here. Because see, Jesus in chapter number 4 had already been to Simon's house and healed Simon's mother-in-law. And so he already had a relationship with Simon. And so when it was time to go out into the deep water, he jumped over in the boat with someone he was in relationship with. Now, I'm going to tell you why, y'all, I was shouting right there. Because when you have relationship with Jesus, he will jump on board with you. Y'all ain't talking back to me. I said, when you are in relationship with Jesus, Brother Rice, he will jump on board right with you. And so watch this. The Bible says that Simon was tired. And the Lord said, Simon, go out to the deep.
All right.
Now, watch this, y'all. Here's what don't make sense. Here's a preacher.
All right.
A carpenter. A rabbi.
All right.
Talking to an experienced fisherman. Now, I ain't sure about you, but one of the things that get me frustrated is when, if I'm working on your house,
All right. Don't
come and tell me how to do my job. When you paid me to do it. Because if you could have done it, it would have already been
done.
Here it is. Simon said, Lord, I'm tired. That's the Elliott version. He says, we've toiled, watch this now, all night. Watch this. How many of y'all, you are tired of toiling? Come on, how many of y'all are tired of struggling? Tired of going from paycheck to paycheck, from week to week, from month to month? But watch this, Jesus says, if you launch out into the deep, watch this, that's what's going to happen in the deep water, you're going to get a boat sinking. Blessing. One of the reasons God can't bless your life the way you want him to is because you're afraid and you're trapped on the shore. But push the person by your time and say, neighbor, it's time to get over in the deep waters. Come on, say, neighbor, it's time to get over in the deep water. See, some of y'all too long, you've been staying on the edge. And you've been staying there, right there on the shore. Afraid to obey an instruction. But is there anybody in the house that say, I don't care what you think, I don't care how you feel, and I don't care your opinion, but when God gives me an instruction, I better obey God than miss my blessing. Do me a favor and hurt your neighbor and say, neighbor, I better obey God than to miss my blessing. And the Bible said, Simon went out there in the deep part of the water that he cast down his net. And the Bible says that when he cast down his net, put your trust in the Lord. Do me a favor and look at your neighbor. And your neighbor is already settled. It's already settled. The devil can't trick me. And the devil can't fool me. My heart is fixed. And my mind is made up. The devil can't get me. He can't get me again. It's already settled. In my mind, it's already settled. In my spirit, it's already settled. On the inside, that whatever God says, I will do it. Is there anybody here that knows that God knows how to do what He says? The Bible declares that God is on the side of the righteous. Is there anybody here that knowing you the righteousness of God Almighty? And because you are right with God, He promised that no good thing will He withhold from you. Is there anybody here who's glad about it? That everything you need, God got your blessing right in the palm of His hand. Look at your neighbor and your neighbor. You get a blessing. I'm a blessing. I'm blessed from the floor up. I'm blessed in the city. I'm blessed in the field. I'm blessed when I come. I'm blessed when I go. I'm blessed when I walk. I'm blessed when I drive. I'm blessed when I fly. I'm blessed when I sleep. My sleep is blessed. My family is blessed. My money is blessed. My kids are blessed. My wife is blessed. And guess what? I'm a blessed man too. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, let me inform you, I'm a blessed child of the King. Is there anybody here that can testify that no matter how bad it looks, I'm still blessed? It don't matter how I feel, I'm still healed. Look at your neighbor and tell a neighbor, I don't care what it looks like, and I really don't care what they say about it. I know that I'm blessed. Is there anybody here that knowing you're blessed, the enemy may disqualify you, but I'm still blessed. The enemy might say, I don't deserve it, but I'm still blessed. Other folk might say that God's not gonna do it, but guess what? I'm still blessed. Shake your neighbor. This time shake him until they move. Until a neighbor, I'm gonna shake you over to my blessing. I'm gonna shake you into what's on me. Get over on you. Is there anybody here that wants the glory to ride upon us? Lift your hand and say, Lord, let the glory ride upon us. Because when I obey God, His glory, His anointing, His power gets upon me. Is there anybody here that can tell God, I'll obey you, I'll trust you, I'll lift you, whatever you say, that's what I'll do. Wherever you lead me, that's where I'll go. Whatever you command, I don't mind. Because after this, there's a blessing in store for me. For the last time, shake your neighbor's hand and say, neighbor, oh neighbor, when you see me doing strange stuff, I'm only obeying God. What I'm trying to do is make sure the overflow comes to me. Yes. Yes. Watch this. I'm done. Here is what you don't want to miss. To Simon, Jesus didn't qualify to tell him his business. Fish would stay at the bottom of the ocean when the sun was up. If they would cast their nets in the green, the fish could see the net. But isn't it amazing how God knows how to hide your blessing?
All right.
Yeah. All right.
Thank you, Lord.
Lord, only two folks got it, Lord. But I'm going to say it again. God, right? God knows how to hide your blessing. See, the devil is telling you, Gina, there ain't no fish. But you think God gonna make the world and not put enough fish in the water? Watch this. Isn't it just like God that when Simon first started fishing, the fish weren't hungry? Imagine this, the same fish that were hungry yesterday, today his cousin and them don't want to eat. It was not that they were not hungry. God, watch this, God had a way of switching their appetite. See, y'all ain't got it yet, see, watch this. When God told Simon to launch out into the deep for a draught or a great catch, everything came in line with the word. That's what you're saying. Fish that only ate at night were hungry in the daytime. Fish who only ate or came to the shore to eat, got hungry in the deep. Y'all ain't got it yet. Anytime God gives you a word, it is on that word that God will change the law of nature. Our challenge is and to be willing to do what God has said. Watch this. We say things like, well, Lord, I don't see it. Baby, you ain't got to see it. See, God knows how to give you a position over those who are more qualified than you. What's this poor more who are less educated than you? They can have degrees up the wazoo. And watch this, because you are God's child, God says, I'll put you at the front of the line. Darn him. So you think that you're going to get yourself there. Listen, I know folks who got 4 or 5 master's degrees and they still live under a bridge. Watch this, I'm going to tell y'all one that y'all know. You know, how many of y'all know Richard? Richard is the guy who come here, the one y'all call a bum. Watch this. Richard has a master's degree. Richard is smart. Talk to him. The boy is smart. But all his degrees didn't help him out. Are you following me? When you follow God's instruction, watch this, your blessing, your expectation is already there. See, watch this, y'all. God didn't make no new fish. God didn't make no new fish. God just had him on hold. Until he decided, watch this, I'm going to move past what I know. Watch this. Until he moved past his normal and do something that's not normal. Yes. See, watch this. Could it be that the reason your whole family can't get blessed is because they are tied to your disobedience. Now, Pastor, where is that in the Bible? Right in the book of Luke. Watch this. The Bible says that there were other boats with him. Watch this now. When his boat began to sink, the Bible says, he called in his partners. He called in all those who were hooked up with him. You see, if you don't obey God, those that God wants you to bless can't be blessed because of your disobedience. I told you, Lord, it can be hard to preach today. I told you already. And God says, if you don't obey me, I can't bless them because watch this, y'all. Well, how many of y'all believe in generational curses? But watch this. If you believe in generational curses, how about believing in generational blessings? See, you know what? Ella Green, long after I leave this earth, I want my great-great-grandkids, I told them, I'm going to get a big picture of me hanging on the wall. So that when they say, yeah, y'all, we live in a lodge, I want somebody to say, it's because Poppy obeyed God. Don't hear me. I want my great-great-great-grandkids to say, he obeyed God. And because he obeyed, see, Rockefeller's great-great-great-grandkids, they never seen him, don't know him, but they live in a lodge right now because he obeyed God. See, what you don't know is that Rockefeller was a tither. Rockefeller, he was a tither. He gave tithe and gave offering. He supported God's work. And God blessed his whole lineage. And they're living good. This man been dead, and they're still living good off his money. Come on, somebody. See, don't think just for you. You want to think generational. The Bible says that everybody who was with Simon, what is y'all, they got blessed. Look at the person by your temple and say, neighbor, if you obey God, I can get my blessing from you. Now, Pastor, come on now. That's not even in the Bible. It's in the same verse. If those ships were not with Simon, everything he caught, watch this, would have got thrown back.
All right.
Everything that God had planned for him. You know, the word was, cast down your nets. That's plural. More than one. Watch this. He didn't have confidence, even though he said, nevertheless, at your word. He said, I'll do it, watch this, but with reservation. Some of you all, let's see, if I can say it like this. You may tithe, but you don't tithe right. Pastor, what's tithing right? You can't get paid four times a week, but tithe to God once a week. Once a month, say, I'm a tither. Come on. I see, this is where the word going to challenge you. Because some of y'all, not only did you not tithe, but you don't even give. Oh, somebody give me a chair. I'm going to sit right here and put it. Come on. And the devil is telling you, I can't afford to. Look, y'all, tithing is God's plan. Offering is God's plan. Amen. Somebody say it's God's plan. It's God's plan. The devil's telling you all he wants is your money. Maybe if I had your money, my reality, your money came by me what's really in my heart. Amen. I've learned that when I release what's in my hand and obey God, Mr. Mary, God is the one responsible for doing for me what he said he'd do. But if I don't obey him, if my hand is tied, I tie God's hand too. God says, if you won't give in, God says, I got time. I ain't giving in either. Come on, somebody. know I said y'all do it the last time, but look at the person by you. Look them in the eyeball. Come on, look at their pretty, brown eyes. Come on, look at them. Come on, look at them. Come on, look at them. Come on. Y'all glasses, put them glasses down. See them pretty old blue eyes, pretty old brown eyes. Look at them. Come on. And tell me, say, neighbor, I got a question for you. When are you going to obey God? Wait for an answer. I heard a few right now. Someone said, I ain't sure, Doc. I ain't there yet. Listen. Y'all sit down. Sit down. Preacher, you come on. You come on. I think everybody here say, I think so. Everybody here, for the most part, I think y'all all members of the church. Listen. I want to say this. Look at me. 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 Family, hear me. Maintaining confidence in God says, God, watch this. This is important. It says, God, I'll obey you and leave the details to you.
That's right. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hear me, family. That God, I'll do it your way and leave the details up to you.
All right.
And it's bad, y'all, that there are people, there are Christians who are struggling. And that's a bad representation of our God. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
You can say amen to that.
Amen.
That's a bad and a misrepresentation of our God. Our enemy family, our God is not void of support. I'll say it again, our God is not void of support. God knows how to do what he said he'll do.
Yes, he does.
And some of you all, you are stopping your own flow because of your disobedience.
All right.
Now I know it's a hard sermon for some of y'all. I know it's hard. My pastor been looking at my giving. No, baby, I don't do that kind of stuff. I don't look at your tithing record. Watch this, I can tell by your need what you're not doing. Because if God promised to supply all of our need, and your need isn't misapplied, then you aren't carrying out Philippians chapter 3. If you read Philippians chapter number 3, what caused the need to be supplied in abundance, watch this, is because they were supporting God's word. Watch this, y'all. Look at me. Look at me. I think y'all be still for 1 minute, okay? Look at me. How many of y'all eat at fast food restaurants? Come on. Watch this. Sometimes you do. But listen, you don't get to the girl, the cashier, and tell her, you know what? That two old big patties is too much money. You pay it. You know why? Because what you see is an instant result. They give it to you. Listen, Philip, and I get that. I get that. You go to the rib house, get them blessed God ribs, you pay your money. You don't tell them, I ain't paying for them doggone rib tips. You pay. They can be $20. You pay. I'm sorry, I pay for mine. Some of y'all don't need them, but you pay anyway. And some of y'all pay twice.
All right now.
Come on. But you don't ever say, I want it, but I ain't paying for it. Because you get instant gratification. In God's system, see, your God's system is not like our world system. God says, if you want what I have, you have to be willing to follow my instructions.
Oh, yes.
Now, watch this now. In the book of Luke, 5th chapter, Simon, we have never got the fish. Watch this. He had a chance to say, Lord, I'm tired. I fished all night. Look, Jesus, I understand you're a preacher. But right now, we ain't in church. I ain't gonna do nothing you're saying. I'm going home. And then watch this. Jesus would have let him go.
Amen.
Y'all missed that. I said Jesus would have let him go. That's the how you know. Because there are some that he called that wouldn't come. Jesus will respect your right to not follow his instruction. Amen. The Bible said in the book of John, says, so what if they don't believe? Does their unbelief make the word of God void? God is not impressed by your opinion. If your opinion does not line up with his opinion. Watch this. In the Bible, when God says to confess, that word confess in the Greek means to agree with God. When we confess, we are agreeing with God. Heavenly family, until you and I learn how to get on the same page with God, I don't care how hard you pray. When you finish praying, the question will always be, did you obey? This is where you all of us, give me something soft for. It's where all of us need to repent. If you've been out of order with God, it's time to repent and get it right. If you've been disobeying willfully, and you know you have, it's time to repent and just tell God, I'm sorry. Now, I know you won't admit it in public, so every head bowed, every eye closed. Everybody, close your eyes. You got two eyes, close them. If you got three, close them too.